start over. I had read some things earlier. I had a really hard time discerning where the Lord wanted to go tonight, and I picked wrong. And so he corrected me. So I keep hearing over and over the words of Jesus when he was cleansing the temple. And he said, "It is written, my house shall be called the house of prayer, but you have made it a den of thieves." And I feel like there is a cleansing in the temple. I feel like this is really pertinent. We're ending 2015, and we're at the beginning of 2016. And I was thinking a lot about, this is our last service of the year together for 2015. And boy, it's time to let it go and move on. But I really think that God wants us to just enter 2016 with prayer. And I know it's the foundation of everything, and it sounds so simple, but purposefully praying together in one mind and one accord. We all have our personal prayer lives, and we all have things, our personal habits, but I feel like the Lord really, something's happened in our houses of prayer as we've added the prayer. I think that that's the fire starters, right? I have that vision in Ankeny about the oil, the river, because we talked about the river. Well, I had the revelation when I was praying for Rick at the Kingdom House of Prayer. I saw just rivers, and those rivers were made of oil, not water. And they were on fire. And I realized that oil, it's what renews. It's the presence of God. It's not the water we drink, but it's the oil that soaks and heals. And it's the balm of Gilead. It's the joy. Yeah. It's what soaks and renews and just gets down deep, and it stays, and it's fragrant. You know, oil is a beautiful thing. And oil, you know, the essential oils thing going on right now, it's healing. I mean, there's everything is in oil. And that fire has been missing. And it hit me when I was talking to Shelley after service, almost a month after we were in Ankeny. And she said, she was kind of joking about her place and everything. She goes, "I like to set fires and watch them burn." And like, poof, epiphany. I'm like, we need fire starters. That's the prayer that starts the fire. It's the spoken word that starts this. We've had the river, but there's been that spark, that fire that's been missing. And boy, when we spark that fire, that oil doesn't just burn out. It burns and it burns and it burns and it burns. It reminds me of that oil lamp in Zechariah. You know, the oil and the fire. Anyway, I'm getting on a tangent. Not what I was going to talk about. But there's so many pieces coming together. And I feel like we're converging, and it all boils down to prayer. And I read this in 1 Timothy, and that's what made me think of it. And I keep hearing the Lord tell me over and over, my house is a house of prayer. My house is a house of prayer. My house is a house of prayer. You are his house. Yep. This building is not his only house. Mm-hmm. I am his house. You are his house. I am a house of prayer. Yep. Right? I am a house of prayer, and I've never thought of myself as a house of prayer, and that's kind of the hip thing, right, is to do these 24-hour prayer burns or the 24-hour praise and worship. And these things, they're popping up all over. And I think that's just part of the Lord's plan. But in 1 Timothy chapter 2, Paul is writing to Timothy. And in the message, this section is called Simple Faith and Plain Truth. The first thing I want you to do is pray. Let's just stop right there. The first thing, our first thing we should ever do is just stop and pray. Mm-hmm. Pray every way you know how. Pray every way you know how and for everyone you know. Pray especially for rulers and their governments to rule well so we can be quietly about our business of living simply in humble contemplation. This is the way our Savior God wants us to live. He wants not only us, but everyone saved, you know. Everyone to get to know the truth we've learned. And there's one God, only one, and one priest, one mediator between God and us, and that's Jesus, who offered himself in exchange for everyone held captive by sin to set them all free. Eventually, the news is going to get out. This and this only has been my appointed work, Paul says, getting this news to those who have never heard of God and explaining how it works by simple faith and plain truth. Since prayer is at the bottom of all of this, prayer is the foundation. What I want mostly is for men to pray, not shaking angry faces. holy hands to God. And I want women to get in there with the men in humility before God. Not primping before a mirror chasing the latest fashions, but doing something beautiful for God and becoming beautiful doing it. And I read that earlier. And then he starts talking about leadership in the church. And I think it's no accident that he talks about prayer and then he talks about leadership. Mm-hmm. You know, those of us who are here are the foundation of what God wants to do in this body. And we need a firm foundation. And that foundation, the bottom of everything, is prayer. And, you know, I'll let the Lord work it all out, but I feel like prayer is going to be more important than ever, I guess is what I'm saying.
Right.
And whether it's together, whether it's for each other, I just think God's going to reveal the things that he wants us to pray for. But nothing happens without prayer.
Right.
And the prayer of a righteous man availeth much. God has given us grace. He's given us revelation of grace so that we know how to pray. We don't pray angry prayers. Angry prayers are just venting. It's not getting us anywhere. It's not changing the situation. We change the situation by letting it go and letting God. We change the situation by speaking his word into things that are not until they appear. That's what changes things. And, I read Facebook while I'm eating my lunch at my desk. Usually I scroll through and everybody's moaning and groaning, or everybody's, you know, some people are very encouraging and very uplifting, and some people are always got a problem or something. And one of my friends said, 2015 wasn't a great year. All three of her kids had been in the hospital at some point. She said, but you know, when I look back, my blessings still outweigh anything that, anything. And I thought, we're so blessed. Yep. We are so blessed. And I know this has been a hard year for a lot of us, for whatever reason, just the pressures, whether, financial, relational, job, whatever it might be. I feel like there's something going on with our church body, whether people, I know it's just busy, everybody getting here, but God has a work to do in this place.
Right.
And I'm very thankful to be a small part of it, and I'm very thankful for every one of you who are a part of it as well, because it takes all of us. Pastor can't do this all by himself.
No.
And I just really, why don't we just start there? Why don't we just pray specifically when we pray tonight? Let's pray for our pastor, and let's pray for Sally. Getting emotional. I love our pastor very much, and we are very fortunate to have him. Whew. I don't know where this is coming from, but it's personal for me because when I got saved all those years ago, 17 years ago, I prayed for somewhere safe to protect me from religion, to protect me from people that wanted to get in between my relationship with God. Because there were a lot of people, a lot of churches that said, no, look at me. I'll teach you what you need to know. Don't look at the word. Don't go to prayer. Look at me, and I'll get you straight with God. And that was my prayer, is I needed somewhere safe.
I'll get it.
Sorry, it'll give me a minute to calm down. Well, it does that one, yes. But anyway, so I'm just all that to say that I'm just very grateful, very thankful for someone who is hungry for the truth of God, who is open to revelation, and who did let go of everything he was taught and opened the Bible and read it like he'd never seen it before and allowed God to do a mighty work in him. And, let's just lift him up tonight. And let's lift each other up. Anybody have any prayer requests or any praise reports tonight? Yeah, Roberto.
Debbie Hart asked for prayer for to regain her strength. She was sick last week, and she said, yes, to have been able to regain her strength. But also to go along with what you just said, I'm also very thankful of this church, because this is where I accepted the Lord as my Savior. And that was almost 3 years ago. But also, I love everybody here. And particularly, I love our pastor, because it's very humbling for me to see a man that treats you and sees you as his equal, not as someone that is superior to you. And that's why I wasn't going to church before, because that was my previous experience with church leaders and other people that were members of the churches that I visited prior and that I had the desire to join, but all that religion that was being thrown at you is what pushed me away.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I said it before, I misdirected my frustration regarding that to God instead of people.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I never came to church until what happened. But I love this place, and hopefully when God's plan in my life manifests and what he promised me comes to pass, I get to stay here unless he wants me somewhere else. But I love it here, and I would like it if my growth would continue to be in this place.
Yeah. Yeah. We would like that too.
Yeah.
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 Thank you, Lord.
Yeah. Yeah, Mike.
Yeah, Cindy went to the doctor today. Her oxygen level was excellent. Been cruising around 93, 94, whatever, but she got to the doctor's today and she didn't even use the portable oxygen machine. She had it with her.
Nice.
But didn't feel like she needed it. She was at 99
praise
with the doctor's, which is God's hands on her. So she'll be back Sunday. She was going to come tonight, but her stomach was giving a little trouble. So pray for all the other things going on for her to get totally healed. But I praise God for what happened today. And she'll go to the pulmonologist and have an heart echo done at the beginning of January. So praying for total healing before these tests. So the tests will reveal there's nothing wrong.
Amen.
She'll be totally healed and restored.
Praise
so.
The Lord. Amen. Yes. Tim.
Yes, one of the things the Lord for all is blessings. He gives us. We was able to go see her grandkids and her sons on Sunday. I thank God for my sons, you know, cause it's just great to see them, and, you know, they're family men, and they believe in the Lord, you know, and they have their things they go through, but, you know, I sometimes will go back on Facebook
title touch the city.
He's
drawing people to this region.
Right.
Because Lou Engel
right.
will also be here up in Ankeny here in January, February, I can't remember, but the embers are starting to burn. Mm-hmm. See, they're starting to draw people in, and the manifestation that you're talking about, these guys are discerning something's going on. I know Franklin Graham's going to all the capital cities through the United States,
right.
but coming at the same time that Lou Engel is also being drawn to Iowa. So there's a lot of stuff going on here that some people are not discerning, but there are some people that are. And the prayer focus is mainly what these two guys are coming for. So that falls into place with what you're speaking about. And there's a pursuit coming on. There's a pursuit coming on for his passion of his presence, the fire of his presence.
Exactly.
When I see that hunger, the Lord has given me a specific time when he wants to release this, and this time's not yet because there's not enough hunger. There's not enough hunger. Until we see that hunger, the Lord's not going to fill up a table and have it sitting there half empty. He's waiting for his people to get hungry. He's waiting for people to cry out, to want his presence.
Yeah.
Right now, everybody's, not everybody, but a lot of people can go through services and go through all their weeks and their services and gatherings and stuff without even the Holy Spirit moving in their midst. And here there's a remnant that are starving because the presence of the Holy Spirit's not being tended to, not being allowed to move in their services. And I know it's got to break the heart of the Lord. And there are many people that are starting to cry out, you know, something's wrong. It's because the hunger's not pointing. And I believe what we're discerning here is that these gentlemen coming in from all around the country are coming in here is because they see something is starting to burn. Something is starting to burn. And they say this place is burned over. I was burned over. It's not worth anything. After Mount St. Helens, I remember they said that land's trash for years. And then in the next year or two, they had the best apple harvests and everything else because of the elements of the earth that were spewed all over the land, and the land was refreshed and restored and produced even greater. I believe the time is coming for Iowa now that theoretically had been burned over, but there's hay and stubble. The hay was gathered, the stubble was burned, but there is new crop coming up now. There's a new crop growing right now, and the Lord's preparing the ground.
Well, and I remember the prophecy that Peter gave at the house of prayer.
Right.
That I think others are perceiving what he saw and spoke out that night was that he's welcome here. And he's here.
Right.
He's here. And that he is the one fanning the flames. Those burnt fields didn't go out. The fire never left.
Right.
They've just been embers burning. And you're right, as the hunger comes, the Holy Spirit comes, and that wind blows, and whew, pretty soon you've got a raging forest fire. That cannot be contained.
One other thing that I was specifically shown is, before Joni was an intercessor for his church, but before her was, I just lost her name, Evelyn Link, the mantle was passed on to Joni. Since Joni went to be with the Lord, there had been a gap. And I believe Shelley has picked that mantle up.
Hmm.
I don't know if I'm wrong or not, but I'm just saying that's what the situation is. So we'll pray for her as she spearheads. And I believe also others are going to be joining us really quick because this is going to be a quick work, but it's going to be a deep, and it's going to be built with a solid foundation on the rock,
mm-hmm.
on the rock. So.
Praise the Lord.
And then we also should pray for Missouri, that big flood.
Yeah.
Our world is protected by Jesus, but it doesn't mean that this couldn't happen, and the hedge of protection that Jesus should be declared over them as well as other people. And that's another thing that gets deep in my heart, and different stuff that irritates people.
stand and go to prayer tonight.
Hallelujah.
Heavenly Father, we come into your house tonight, a house of prayer, Lord. We come and we lift up our pastor tonight.
Yes.
To be with Nathan,
yes.
Lord, that you restore his
yes.
body, his heart, his mind,
yes.
his soul, Lord. Encourage him. Continue
yes.
to pour out revelation, Lord, as he searches your word, as he seeks after your spirit, Lord. That you put a hedge of protection around him and his family, Lord, and Sally, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Let health, let them walk in divine health. Let them walk in divine prosperity, Lord. Let them lack for nothing. Jesus, and we pray for every member of this body, Lord, as
yes,
we close
Lord.
Out 2015 together tonight. Jesus,
yes.
we are so thankful as we look back to all the blessings, Lord, for all the words that you've spoken, Lord, not just from your word, but from the hearts of your people, Lord. The visions, Lord, the dreams, Lord, that have been shared this past year, those that are yet to come to pass, Lord. We thank you, Lord, as you continue to give us vision as we look ahead, Lord. We thank you for where you've brought us, Lord, but the work is not finished. We thank you that you've chosen us to be part of this body, in this house, in this time. We pray for the state of Iowa, Lord, that many have just turned their back on and thought, oh, it'll never be anything in your kingdom. But we know differently, Lord. We know differently because we're here and you are here in our midst, Lord. As we gather together through our services and through our house of prayer, Lord, you are here in the midst, Lord. You bless us with your presence. We need you, Lord. We come for you, Lord. We don't come to put on a show. We don't come to be entertained. We come to be in your presence, Lord. We come to be changed from being in your presence in our worship, Lord, to worship you, to learn your word, to be transformed from glory to glory as you renew our mind through your word. Thank you for a pastor that loves your word. Thank you for a pastor who is bold to speak truth, whether it's popular or unpopular, but who will stand up and speak truth. Thank you for his faithful heart, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that no matter whether there's two or three here, he comes and he gives the word as if preaching to the multitudes. Thank you that he gives us good food, meat of your word. Thank you for the revelation of grace, of the finished work of your cross, Lord. Thank you as you draw each and every person from the north and the south and the east and the west. We thank you for the divine connections you restored this past year. As the houses of prayer are becoming intertwined across the state, Lord, that you continue to develop the relationships, develop those networks, Lord, develop your kingdom. Let your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. You are our daily bread. We hunger and we thirst for you alone. Let us hunger and thirst for you as never before. those fears, those worries. Let us let go once for all, Lord, and reach out for you, Lord. Let our cups overflow with the oil of gladness, the balm of Gilead. Oh, we thank you, Lord. Thank you for your presence in this place. Thank you for your purpose and your plan for each and every one of us. We glorify you, Lord. To you be all the glory, Lord. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. All right. Our first Eastern Gate House of Prayer of 2016 is going to be a doozy. I can just tell, just speaking out loud in this place, I can't wait for what the Lord's doing right now, starting right now.
The thing that's getting dropped on me is called The Door Is Open.
So, I'm excited. I don't know about you guys, but I'm excited. It's only good. It's only good. I promise you, it is only good.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Let's speak the word tonight. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Yes, Lord. That one, right? Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
But I like your enthusiasm. I like his enthusiasm. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
Hallelujah.
Yes. Roberto, do you want to take the offering tonight? Please? Please? Thank you.
The rocks crying out. What Roberto demonstrated, I don't know if he understood it or not, but we just got done speaking it, and as we were speaking it, these walls were absorbing it, and when he spoke it, it almost sounded like the walls were releasing it back into our atmosphere. So, don't let it surprise you when these things start happening.
We're always looking for things through the normal channels that they would normally have. We normally expect to get blessed through church. Or, you know, I think we need to go into things with an expectation, but not be presumptuous about where things are going to come from.
Amen.
What's going to come?
And what's going to come? Yeah, I think we cheapen some of God's blessings because we think it can only happen a certain way through a certain person at a certain time. And you know, I think we're going to learn some new things.
And the manifestations that Suzanne's been talking about most likely are not going to be the types of manifestations that we have seen in the past.
Amen. That's right.
His mercies are new every morning.
Yeah.
And there's manifestations.
Mm-hmm.
Can also be new every morning.
Well, and the other thing, all of the other outpourings and revivals have either been oil or fire, but there's never been one oil and fire.
There you go. I love the sparkly gold coming through the atmosphere.
Mm-hmm.
You can see that again. I love those situations, and I love that when the fire of God just falls on people, things manifesting in different ways and stuff. And let's not limit them to that.
Whatever you want, Lord.
You're going to see things that you haven't even heard about. I know a lot of things that we've talked about, the double baptisms, where someone's getting baptized in water, and the Holy Ghost hits them.
I didn't know that had a name.
Yeah, double
baptism. That's what happened to me. It was like lightning through my fingertips. Down on my toes and back out. I couldn't walk. I think I was supposed to talk in tongues, but I didn't know to. The pastor looked at me. I looked at him and we started bawling. Like, bawling. He could barely say the words to baptize me. It was terrible.
And last week, when I was trying to read the last Christmas hymn we were trying to do, I couldn't see the music. And I thought, what the heck's going on with my eyes? Did you ever get oil in your eyes?
Yeah. Blurry.
Did
you
get oil in your eyes?
Yeah.
It gets blurry.
Yeah, it gets
blurry. And I don't know where that came from, okay?
Well, I do.
In 1 Kings, it talks about the presence, the cloud of the presence of the Lord came into the temple, and the priests could not do their service. It's starting.
Mm-hmm.
If you get to the point where you can't play, you can't sing, whatever, just release it to the Lord. A lot of times, they talk about it and nothing ever happened. They just all hit the deck and that was it. And sometimes I believe coming now is a time where things will hit the deck and other things will rise up that He wants to release you completely of yourself, that He can raise you up to who He wants you to be.
Look at that Christmas songs, Christmas carols could be so amazing. I mean, for real, I've never had that happen.
Never. This is the first year I've ever experienced the Holy Ghost moving in the midst of Christmas carols.
I think as a church we also need, I don't think we're asking for enough.
Right.
And I don't think we're asking always for the right things. I mean, and I'm not trying to judge any person or anybody here, but you know, even myself. So the verse the Lord gave me in Pensacola was John 15:16. For you did not choose me, but I chose you and ordained you that you should go and bring forth fruit, that your fruit should remain, that whatsoever you ask the Father in my name, He may give it to you. And also John 16:15, which where Jesus says, I don't have this one memorized, you know, that everything the Father hath given, you know, the Father has, He's given it up to me. Well, you know, what I'm praying for now is that for me, Jamie, Jacob, that our lives would bear good fruit that remains. You know, we're not, I don't think the things we're asking for are bad, but I don't think we're asking for enough. I think we're limited by what's happened in our past. We're limited by what we've seen. And we can only ask for those things that we know. We can't get out of the paradigm that we are, you know, for more.
I believe the Lord is saying that through you because that's His heart. He says, I've shown you these things, but that's not all there is. I want to show you more. He's asking us to ask for Him to release the more of what He wants to release.
The more. Pray for the more. That's our prayer, is for the more.
like
open door.
The open door.
The more God, whatever
well,
more is of whatever.
What I've been praying lately is I want to be Jesus to my world. I mean, you know, you hear stuff about, you know, when we've gone to the Loggies about the miracles that they've received. I'm like, you know, God, we should all be experiencing life. We should all be free to do that, because the world's crying out for that. They're not coming here. We need to go there.
On the way here, I was listening to a song, and he said, the dead will rise when you walk in the room.
Mm-hmm.
Because resurrection power is who you are. It's who he is. It's who we are. Resurrection power to bring the dead things to life.
Mm-hmm.
Bodies, relationships, dead things will come to life. Not just the whole dead body, but the dry bones, where you don't even know what it was or who it was.
Mm-hmm.
They're going to rise.
Yes.
In the name of the Lord.
In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah.
Baruch haba, Hashem Ha'el.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Starts with vision.
True. And that's the thing about vision. You have to establish it, and you also have to keep it in front of you.
Yes.
Because when you lose sight of it.
That's good.
Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me, save that thou art. Thou presence, my life.
Lord, give us eyes to see and ears to hear, Lord. Yes, Lord. As this year slips away, you have been our focus, Lord. Your voice is becoming clearer, Lord, each day. Give us ears to even hear clearer, Lord. Just as Jesus was healing that blind person, Lord. His first sight was, what do you see? And he said, I see trees. And then after a while, he said, I see men. Lord, we hear bits and pieces of what you are saying, Lord. Touch us once again, Lord, that we can hear clearly, Lord. Because, Lord, time fades and days go by. Earthquakes and buildings falling from the sky. And yet a new day breaks, and still another reason why to live.
are broken from the hurt they have inside. And yet a new day breaks, and there's still another reason why to live. We are the generation who will stand and fight in the midst of all the darkness. We'll carry the light. In the midst of all the darkness, we'll carry the light.
We thank you, Lord, because you give us the courage and the boldness to go out into this world and show your people, those that you are calling, who you are, so that they come to you. We pray that you manifest in the service and that this message brings the word that you want me to convey to your people and share with your people. In Jesus' name, everybody say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
All right. I'm excited. I think the Lord gave me this word to share with you. And Pastor asked me on Sunday if I could do this. I felt very excited about it. And as I was thinking about it, when I was putting two and two together, I was like, oh, wait, this is the last service of the year. So it makes it all more special. And I was thinking, okay, Lord, what do you want me to talk about? And I said, well, how about talk about how the year is ending, but a new year is starting. So as I was going through these things, I started thinking about all the stuff that has happened to me throughout the year. And, you know, we start thinking, when we get close to December 31st, this is something that I learned recently, well, not too recently, probably like 2 years ago. And this is something that I had never seen before. Some people that have sent me Christmas cards, they kind of like make this list of what happened to them during the year. And they start sharing it with people that they care and their friends and all those things. And as I was thinking about that, you know, we start thinking, okay, let me make a list of what happened to me in 2015, for example. And as we start going through those, both the good and the bad, and we start reminiscing on those things, we start making plans to change some things that happened to us so that way they don't happen again. And it's typically when it comes to negative experiences. That's one thing that I was noticing. So as I was saying, you know, I thought it was very curious, you know, how people or families, you know, they put together all these summaries of all the stuff that happened, but typically they focus only on the good, and then they share it as part of their Christmas cards tradition. And that's something that I had never seen until actually I came to the United States. So I sat down and I said, okay, let me think about what has happened to me in 2015. You know, this year has been very eventful for me, as I have shared some things with you before. And I started making a list of things that I remembered that have happened to me, both good and bad. So here's an example of a few things that happened to me in this past year. One of the things that happened was I had one of the greatest spiritual battles that I have ever experienced since becoming a Christian, giving my life to the Lord. And it was very interesting for me how I saw myself questioning God. And I mean, I don't necessarily think that I was being disrespectful. It was because he had said some things to me previously that were the complete opposite of what he was asking me. And I caught myself asking God why, when he was taking me in that opposite direction as to where he was leading me first. Other thing that happened to me, I moved out of my house. My mother and my sister came to visit, so that's a positive. I gave my very first message in church. And then I gave another message. And another.
Lord.
I got divorced. I also met some amazing people that now I consider my friends. I also made the decision of starting to work on getting healthy and fit. And that's because of some things that the Lord has shown me. I want to make sure that I do my part from a human perspective so that I can enjoy those for as much as I can while I'm still here. So those are just a few examples of some things that have happened to me. And, you know, I'm pretty sure there's more. I just either don't remember or chose to forget them on purpose. So as I was thinking about this, I started thinking, okay, Lord, what scripture can I relate to this? And this is what he gave me, Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, said the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. The Lord has a plan for all of us. we start knowing Him and experiencing Him, I believe that these things are being gradually revealed to us by the Holy Spirit. I don't think that everything that we are supposed to know is revealed to us all at once, because it's going to be too much. And we have limitations as humans that we cannot comprehend fully everything that is God-related, which is why He gives it to us in little bites, you know, as we continue to grow. So little by little, we start knowing and understanding all these things that He has in place for us. We get an insight into what we will have as sons and daughters of God, as heirs of His promises. We get that insight when we start renewing our minds to His Word. You know, Susanna was speaking on Sunday about letting go. I'm going to piggyback on you. Little message from Sunday. You know, letting go of things, letting go of the past, just letting go. And it's funny because when she was saying letting go, I was standing back there and all I could think about was the song from Frozen, and I'm singing it in my mind. You never seen that movie? I can lend it to you. I bought it a few weeks ago. It's pretty nice. So I was thinking, okay, we gotta let go of things. We gotta let go of those things that are holding us, of the past. And I started thinking, and I started seeing, you know, maybe that's why some people feel stuck. They feel that they cannot move forward or continue on with their lives. And then those are the people that you constantly see complaining. Oh, this isn't getting any better for me. Well, maybe you're not speaking the right words, you know? I have seen people like this. I know people like this. I'm friends with people like this. I used to be that way. But this is what the Lord impressed upon me. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5. Not there. Sorry, I have it right here. So trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not unto thine own understanding. Trust in the Lord. And I ask myself, is that an easy thing to do? No, it's not. It's not an easy thing to do because us as humans, we want to hold on to whatever little control we think we have over things when we know clearly that we have none whatsoever. And when we do this, that's when we get stuck in the past. We're not able to move past these things that we used to have and so desperately want to get back. We cannot move on. I have been there. I have done that. As I continue to grow as a Christian, and I continue to listen to the Lord, and continue to study and meditate on His Word, He revealed this to me. Revelation chapter 21, verse 5. And he that sat upon the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, Write, for these words are true and faithful. He makes all things new. But in order for him to make all things new, we need to do as it says, in Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5, we need to trust in Him. In there is where the key to this change lies. We must let go of these things that are preventing us from moving forward. But then, when you think about it, when we hold on to these things, when we hold on to the past, we stop what it says in Jeremiah 29:11. We are putting a barrier to the plans that God has for us, that he wants to make sure that are manifested in our lives, because we continue to hold on to these things that we know are not good for us. So he has plans for our lives, but we are not allowing him to move and those plans to be manifested. But then this is what he says about that. Isaiah chapter 43, verses 18 and 19. Remember ye not the former things, neither consider the things of old. Behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? I will even make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. I like how he says, shall you not know it? You didn't know? Is this news for you? You know? He gave this word to Isaiah, and then in Revelation, he says this to us again. He says, I make all things new. And then he says, write it down, because these words are true and faithful. You know, I really like it when someone is telling you something and they think that what they're saying is the absolute truth, and they're like, write it down right now. I'm telling to you today, December 30th at 8:18 p.m., that the Hawkeyes are going to win on Friday, you know? So write it down. I'm telling you right now. I'm prophesying that that's going to happen. And I'm not a fan. Pastor's going to be proud of me for saying that. Yeah. So it's hard for us to let go of things. We're humans, you know, it's understandable. Because we know that he makes all things new is why we are able to move forward. But we have to trust in him. Revelation chapter 21, verse 4.
Matthew.
Revelation 21, 4. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. When you allow the Lord to do in your life what he wants to do, when you let him do those plans that he has for you, you are a new creature. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new.
Mm-hmm.
Everything is new. He makes everything new. Have you been hurt? Yes. Has someone broken your heart? Probably. Have you become hardened because of it? Maybe. Well, you don't have to worry, because he'll take care of it. And I'm going to prove it to you. Ezekiel chapter 36, verse 26.
Thirty-six, twenty-six.
A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. And I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh.
Come on.
This is truth. He can do this, and he will do it. You want to know why? Because he did it to me.
Come on.
And I talked about this not too long ago when I was talking about forgiveness. This prophecy that he gave to Ezekiel was fulfilled in my life. I knew the exact moment when it happened. I know it now, but not at the time. But that was 15 years ago when he changed my heart. But I didn't know it until now. So I know that it was him.
Hallelujah.
But here's the best part. Not only is he going to do this, but he's going to do much more. Go to verse 27, please. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you shall keep my judgments and do them. So not only he's going to give you a new heart, he's also going to put his spirit within you. Isn't he good?
Amen.
Verse 28. And you shall dwell in the land that I gave to your fathers, and you shall be my people, and I will be your God. So think about it. You're thinking, God, I have a hard heart. Can I have a new heart? And God says, of course you can. I'm going to give you a new heart and a flesh. And I'm going to put a new spirit within you. Thank you, Lord. Wait, there's more. Not only am I going to put a new spirit within you, I'm going to give you my spirit.
Yes.
And not only am I going to give you my spirit, you're going to dwell in the land that I gave your fathers, and you're going to be my people, and I'm going to be your God. And I have said that I will never leave you nor forsake you.
That's right.
And I am a God that cannot lie.
Yeah.
And because I am a God that cannot lie, you better believe what I'm telling you is true, and that's how good I am.
Amen.
That's how good God is.
Hallelujah.
And this is the last thing that I want to share. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 20 through 24. But you have not so learned Christ, if so be that you have heard him and have been taught by him, and the truth is in Jesus, that you put off concerning the former conversation the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lusts, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and that you put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness. 2015 is your old man. Don't hold on to anything that happened in 2015 that is going to prevent you from moving forward in 2016. That is going to prevent God from doing in your life the plans that he tells us in Jeremiah 29:11 that he has for us. Look at 2016 as your new self. Put it on and go about this year knowing and believing that everything he said he's going to do for you is going to happen.
Hallelujah.
That's my message. You're dismissed. In Jesus' name. Be blessed. Happy New Year. I'll see you on Sunday.